dropping knowledge and edutainment on you 5 days a week. Here are Tim and Sid.
Hello, Canada, and hockey fans in the United States and Newfoundland.
Here's Lemieux. The center penalty coming up. Look at Lemieux. Oh, my heavens. What a goal. What a move. Lemieux. Oh, baby.
It is Gilmore waiting. Waiting around the net. Waiting. He's open.
Gilmore. Solo job. And he's won it in a second overtime period. How about that?
They're trying to hang on and get a break. It's going to be a break. It is Joe.
You know, Tim, when
smile on my face, by the way.
Yeah, I'm smiling everywhere. When you think of some of the great play-by-play guys in the history of this country,
mm-hmm.
Foster Hewitt, you heard him off the front.
Mm-hmm.
Danny Gallivan.
Yes, sir.
Don Chevrier. Big shout-out to Don Chevrier.
Yep.
Don Whitman, one of my favorites.
Both of ours.
Saturday nights in Georgia. Our next guest is on the list. Over 40 years with the CBC, he is a Hockey Hall of Famer. Welcome to Tim and Sid Uncut from Hockey Night in Canada, Bob Cole. Welcome, Mr. Cole.
Well, thank you very much, and with whom am I speaking now?
My name is Sid Seixeiro, sir. I'm Sid? Alongside Tim Micallef. It's a pleasure to have you.
Okay, Tim and Sid. Nice to be here.
When you hear some of those calls that we just played, and it brings a smile to our face, does it bring a smile to your face, and is there a couple that just jump out at you as... I hate to call them signature calls because you're just doing your job, but are there a few that jump out to you and grab you and bring that smile to your face?
You know what? When I was listening to that, I had no warning that you had these. I'd love to hear those again, but I want to ask you to play them again. But
we can listen to
them
again.
Yeah, it kind of
no
brings
problem.
Back memories. Sorry?
I said we can listen to them again, no problem.
Yeah, but it brought back a lot of memories there in one quick stroke of the pen, as they say. It was pretty good. It sounded exciting. Yeah, it was okay.
It was better than okay, yeah. Bob. I got to tell you, from two guys who've been listening to you for a long time. When you know, going back to just kind of your history with the CBC, when you're on a plane, you're traveling, you have some downtime in the day. Do you think about some of the legendary moments you were a part of, or are those thoughts for another day, for when you walk away from the mic?
You know what? When you do something and you just played some of them, and they're over and gone. When I'm on a plane, as you say, I'm thinking about the next game, and I've got to do it again, and hopefully do it right, and try hard, and you know, it comes rather easy for me because I love the darn game so much, and you know, if I go to the rink in the morning, which I always do, and I meet the coaches, and maybe I get a chance to talk to some of the players, and you get in the darn mood for the game, and you feel their nervousness, and you know, I've been kind of through that in an amateur way, of course, but it's all relative. And when I get to the booth, there hasn't been a day yet, thank God, that I haven't felt butterflies getting ready in the booth to do a hockey game. And when they turn out to be, well, like that last one, for instance, with Boston winning the chance to go meet Vancouver for the Stanley Cup, a 1-0 game in the building, filled to the rafters, as they say, and the excitement, you could cut it. Oh, my goodness. I just love it. I really do. I'm going to miss it.
Listen, when we were doing our due diligence for this interview, I had heard a story that you were trying to decide between being a pilot and doing what you do. Is that true? And was there a conversation that led you to go this way?
There were many conversations. I guess I did a little bit of both, I should say. More of doing hockey broadcasts and radio. And I am reminded so many times now when I meet old friends that when we played hockey on the ponds and the lakes during the winter, all these young years when you're in your teens and even before that, that apparently I used to imitate Foster doing the game as we played on a Saturday morning for about 8 hours or 9 hours a day on a Saturday. So I guess I love that, and it turned out where I got a job in a radio here at home in St. John's, and I had to quit hockey because I began broadcasting, and the owners decided that maybe I'd be better served for myself if I quit the game playing and started broadcasting. So we did something like 80, 90 games a year, and that was quite interesting. But to answer your question, yeah, I love flying. I got a flying scholarship with the Air Cadets, and when I was 17, I guess, and then I learned to fly in Yarmouth, Nova Scotia, and I went on from there and got my commercial license, and it looked like I was going to fly, and that's what I wanted to do. Funny thing happened. Where I was at the Montreal Forum, and the Canadians were in their October training, September, October. I guess it was October in those days. And I was telling Bernie Jeffrey on that I was in Montreal to do a course with Trans-Canada Airlines, which eventually became Air Canada. And I remember Bernie saying to me, the Boomer said, "You don't want to do this, Bob. You've got to play hockey. That you've got to broadcast. If you can't play with us, and I know you can't, you've got to broadcast. Never mind that flying." And, you know, it's a funny thing. A hero like that, you know, to me he was, I'd say, wow, that was something. And so I guess one thing led to another. The next thing I'm working with CBC Radio and doing some Sunday night games with Foster and Danny and so on. It ends up becoming one of the Hockey Night in Canada broadcasters. And I've enjoyed every second.
On the line with Bob Cole of Hockey Night in Canada. Bob, clearly the passion you have for what you do is still there. It was evidence, as you mentioned, Friday night in Boston. I mean, you could just feel the energy in the building. It was an outstanding game.
Yep.
I'm curious, how many more years do you see yourself doing this?
God permitting, I can go on and on and on, like the little guy with the battery. You know what I mean? I don't ever think about quitting. I guess someday they'll ask me to quit or boot me out or whatever. But I hope they don't. I hope they let me go as far as long as I feel I can do it. If I feel I'm not interested, or I feel like I can't handle this, or I feel I don't have that passion anymore, well, then I'll do us all a favor, and I'll say, okay, I don't know what I'll do, but I'll have to go find something else to do. But hockey is my life. It has been my life. I love it, and I'd love to be in Vancouver tonight working, but I guess that's not to be.
You know, I think there's no one that conveys the energy in the building better than you do. And we felt that in that Boston game. Is there a secret to that, conveying that energy, or is it just the fan in you bursting out while you're doing your job?
Well, as I just tried to say, it's tough to explain, I suppose. I get quite involved in the game. I really do. And sometimes I guess I've been accused of maybe being a little bit too much that way, but I can't help it. You know, it's me. It's the way I feel about the hockey game, and I just pray for a good game. People ask me about my predictions for a game. I never do that, never will, and never have. But I will say, I just hope that the goalies are on and we have a good game. And it's so exciting. It's the best game in the world, and when there's so much on the line, like the Stanley Cup now coming up in Vancouver, and Boston coming through another 7-game series to go on. There's so much to it, you know, and Vancouver are starving for a cup. It'll be their first if they can manage this. And people tell me they might be winning this. I don't know. We'll see.
Well, I mean, Bob, you've seen more of this Bruins team this postseason than basically anyone. Who needs to be at their best for Boston to pull the upset here?
Well, I don't want to single anybody out, but I think I should say that Tim Thomas is going to be fine. Don't worry about him. A veteran. He's a great goalie. Luongo, great goalie. They've got great stats going in, both of them. I think the Boston power play better start getting righted. It's been dismal. They've got to get it going. I think they had one power play goal on the road in the playoffs, and they better do better than that. But overall, their power play has to work. And along those lines, they'd better watch taking penalties, because Vancouver is dynamite on the power play. So I don't know what's going to happen.
We'd be remiss if we had you on and we didn't talk a little bit about Winnipeg. What was your reaction in the news that Winnipeg will be getting their team back?
Oh, that's great. It's fabulous. I mean, they were great fans in Winnipeg. I remember doing some games out there on CBC Radio and then later television, and Oh, yeah. It's tremendous to have another team in Canada, too, you know. Winnipeg fans have been starving for NHL hockey. Now they're going to get it, and they'll support it. I wish them all the very best. It'll be great.
Bob, also making news today is that Colin Campbell is going to step away from the disciplinary role. Word is Brendan Shanahan will be taking over. I mean, you've known Brendan many years. Do you think he's the guy for the job right now? And what do you think needs to be done from your angle up top? The game's gotten so much faster. What needs to be done to curtail the concussion issue that's dominated?
You know what? I can't answer that question. I wish I could. I don't know what happened. Were there concussions years ago and we just didn't hear about them? Or the players getting just too darn big? And I think the players, though, some, not all. You can't paint a picture of one and say that's the way they all are. They sometimes some of them lose maybe a little respect on the ice. Maybe that's what I hear people talking about. Respect. There should be more respect. I don't know. It's a tough game. Tough to call these things about body hits, especially head hits. You can't take the checking out of the game. You might change the game forever, and it might not be good. I remember over in Moscow years ago in the 70s when I did the CBC radio, 72 and 74, the WHA team, I went to a game at the Luzhniki Arena in Moscow one night and watched two Russian teams play. I don't know if the Soviet Wings or Dynamo or who the heck they were, but there was two Russian teams playing, and I thought I'd go see it to see how they played each other. It was beautiful to watch. Lovely passing, or tape-to-tape passing. They were circling back and making all these 360s and attacking. I think the score was something like 9-7, and I was completely bored. It wasn't the type hockey that you grew up with, and I didn't realize that till I watched this. And I said, oh, my, if we had this hockey at home, I don't know what would happen. Everybody would give up. So you can't change the game. The game has been terrific for a zillion years. Please don't make too many more changes. I'm not sure if I agree with some of the changes that were made. I'm not sure if that red line thing is what it should be. You get the argument that, well, Bob, the game is faster because of that. Don't you agree? You're darn right it's faster. The players are faster. They're all shooting harder. And the goalie's got to be better. I remember doing a game in Toronto not that many years ago, maybe 4 or 5 years ago. And the play started, it was Boston, actually, in Toronto. And I always use this as an example. When somebody tells me the game is really faster now because there's no red line called. So the game started, and somebody told me we went over 8 minutes without a stoppage. It was end-to-end, back and forth, terrific skating, great passing. The shots were 2-1. The score was 0-0. And I said, what happened? Nothing. I'm not sure if that's because there's no red line and they're allowed to lead that thing. And coaches today are so good. They've got so much video going. They can read other teams, and they prepare so well, and they can solve any situation. If you give them a 4-on-4, they'll figure a way to do it. A 5-on-5, they're figuring that all the time. No red line, they'll figure that. They'll set up a 1-3-1 thing and all this. I don't understand half it, but they can do that, and teams are better that way. So don't change too much, guys. We got a great team and a great game.
Well, Bob, the message is same to you. Don't change at all.
Yeah.
Mr. Cole, before we let you go, just...
Don't call me Mr. Cole.
Oh, sorry.
Me feel...
Sorry, Bob.
All right.
We feel like we have to, though. Hold on a second.
No. Yeah.
It's a compliment. He doesn't call anybody Mr.
Oh, baby. Yeah.
Bob, finally, just from two guys who've been, okay, been watching you for years.
Thanks.
What game in your career, if you had to pick one, do you look back on and say that was the best call I've ever had in my life?
Oh, my. Well, I can't call it a best call, you see. I mean, that's not for me. That's for you.
Mm-hmm.
For me, I can't pick one game. You know, it's so tough. I've had so many 7 games. I've had, you know, so many great playoff games. And, of course, the emotion will never be equaled as that of the – of the 72 eighth game in Moscow with Team Canada. We'll never find a thing like that again. That script is totally out of whack, you know. How can you get down to the last game and go into the third period, down two goals and come out and win it? 6-5, and how can you do that? I don't think you will. I get goosebumps now just thinking about it. It was marvelous, and people who were not around then, it's tough to explain it to them with the emotion that we were all involved in. And it was quite something. Don Orie was not playing when we got over to Moscow. He played the first couple of games, I think, maybe in Canada. And we became friends, and I invited him up in the booth that eighth game, and we had a little small area there. Fred Scambatti was doing the color, and I was doing the play-by-play on CBC Radio. And I got Don to sit there to my right, and he watched the whole game, loved it. And when it came down to the end, I remember talking with him in the second intermission, and I said, "What's going to happen now? We're down 5-3. Are we going to? What do you think?" And he said, "We're going to have to go all out and get one early. That's what they're talking about in there now. And if we get one early, well, then who knows? It's up for grabs." Well, we got one early. And then we got another one, as everybody knows. And then the big goal by Paul Henderson with, less than a minute left. And the game was over, and they were celebrating on the ice, and the bench was on the ice. And I looked at Don Orie. He wasn't saying a word. And he had tears streaming down his eyes, down his cheeks from his eyes. And I said, "Oh, my." I mean, we were all so caught up in this thing. You know, can't explain it any more than that. It was, and I don't think I'll ever see another series that ends in a situation like that. Perfect.
I say this in all honesty. Anytime you'd like to come on and tell stories, we would be more than happy to have you on.
Okay.
This has been a distinct pleasure for both of us. We really appreciate it, Mr. Cole.
Okay, thanks for inviting me, and I hope everything goes right in the Stanley Cup Final.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks for having me, guys.
Thanks, Bob. I got to call him Bob.
There is Bob Cole.
All right, I'm
telling
good.
Stories from.
I'm good. I can quit. I'm going back to the grocery store. I'm done.
It's so funny. Right after we were talking about Kareem being able to tell the stories about Wilt Chamberlain, I'm 35. You're telling me I'm old. I wasn't born for 72. And to hear those stories from a guy who was there is amazing. I hope you enjoyed that.
Yeah, I was about to say, Tim and I were in the room smiling the entire time, and hopefully you enjoyed that as much as we did.
There were a couple times when both of us lifted our hands and then just sat back from the microphone and said, "Here we go."
Yeah, because clearly, like, Bob was going for another lap. He thought the story was done. No.
Circled back.
He's taking the victory lap. Oh, just
he was like the
stuff.
Russian teams at Luzhniki.
I was about to say, I couldn't add. I was about to say, no Bobby Clark on the ice for those games at Luzhniki.
No slashing either.
Luzhniki's one of the arenas in world hockey that I'd love to be at one day. Like it sounds like it's a pretty humble place. Like it's not what you would expect.
It's got that lore.
Yeah, but I just want to kind of walk in there, you know, like just where 72 teams would walk out. I'd love to see Luzhniki one day.
My old man played there. Eh?
Oh yeah,
yeah.
You never told me that.
Yeah,
that's pretty wild.
When they won the Allen Cup with the Windsor Bulldogs, he toured Russia with that team. Ted Lindsay was with them before any of the NHL teams went over. And they would stop in every little town in Russia.
Nice.
And they would play the local team, except the local team was always the same dudes. They just basically
they were really local.
they brought the national team to every stop so that they could kick their ass.
Nice.
And they basically did.
That's great. I have a feeling we're very late. Are we late, Bronstetter?
Got to wrap it up.
Rapid fire.
Rapid fire.
In an election we haven't seen as hotly contested since Bush versus Gore, Sepp Blatter, renamed, reelected, the president of FIFA, in 10 words or less. Your thoughts?
10 words or less.
Sepp Blatter is a crooked fuck.
I got 4 words. Bullshit.
If you add it up, that's like 6 words.
That's about 10 combined.
We still have a few words to spare.
Lady Gaga admitted that she unknowingly went bankrupt and was $3 million in debt due to spending outrageous amounts of money on costumes before her Monster Ball tour. Are costumes necessary for her success and appeal, do you think?
Yeah, the shtick, that's her shtick. But she went bankrupt?
She was $3 million in debt.
Come on.
Beforehand, because it got so out of control and she had no idea.
Yeah, that's a wild story. But, like, if you see her set design, it's not hard to believe the money they might spend on that. But it's still kind of dumb that you get to that point.
And why aren't the label paying for it?
Or the
tour company?
Well, because labels...
labels aren't making
labels
a lot of money
are in
either.
The business of...
They have a one meat dress clause, I think.
Yes, yeah. Very good.
Only thing worse than your York rapist, maybe record labels.
I didn't carpool with them. Jason Terry sleeps in a pair of his opposing team's game shorts before... when he goes to bed the day before a game, the superstition
just,
he's following.
Go to the next question.
Through to college.
Just go to the next
What's
question.
What's the strangest superstition that you guys follow?
I got a penny in my back pocket every day. I've said this on the show before.
Yeah, I don't
DJ
have
looked at me cross-eyed when I said it.
And we won't revisit it. I have none. I don't think I have
You don't
a
have one? You got to have one superstition.
No, I don't. I'm not a superstition.
You don't step on a crack because you're breaking with this back or nothing like that?
No, okay. Nothing.
All right. I got one. It's just the penny. And I will pick up a penny on any floor except a washroom floor. If I see a penny on the floor, that shit's getting picked up.
Lucky penny.
Lucky penny. Except when there's feces on it.
Served you well.
I want to thank Bob Cole for joining Tim and Sid Uncut.
You know what was incredible about that interview, Sid? And I don't want to go too long because I know we're nearly out of time. There was about two tweets on Twitter during the time that Bob Cole was speaking.
Yeah, because normally... Live Show Nation have ADD, and they're just on there all the time.
Yeah, and either they were incredibly bored, or they were completely and utterly...
You know what, Tim? With all due respect, if they were bored, I could give a fuck.
Locked in. I think it's the latter.
I hope it's the latter.
I think because the first one that came through was from Tommy Huds. That interview with Bob Cole was top cheese, incredible. So
that's a highlight of my week. I want to thank Bob Cole. Bob, as his friends call him, for stopping by.
We are now on a first-name basis with Bob Cole.
Enjoy game one of the finals. We'll talk to you tomorrow.
Where do you think you're going?
Clark, I think it's best if everyone just goes home.
It's over.
Please, don't miss me.
Oh, my God, look at that whale.
It's over?
It's over! It's over, ladies and gentlemen!
The that's all, folks.
Listen to me! It's gone, okay? It's over.